They're off to a Christmas party. I remember when he used to read Luke 2 every Christmas Eve to his family. Gave them all such joy. March 15th, spring. I just cleaned the house. He picked me up, but only to wipe away the dust. He's pretty busy thinking about how he's going to afford another child. If he only knew, I have the perfect words for him. March 20th. I got packed into a suitcase for some reason and never got taken out. Just tucked away in the pocket. You know, the one with the net. April 14th. His father is sick and they're off to the hospital. Romans 8 could give him perspective. It could give the family hope. John 3 would be great for him to share with his dad, but they left me here. June 8th, summer. The kids are out of school and having fun. They never pick me up though, probably because he doesn't anymore. He watched them play through the window, but he was sad about something. There's so much in my Psalms for him to read. August 19th, his father passed away and we're going to the funeral. I thought for sure I'd get open today, but no. Just carried along, but never opened. I wanted to help so much. October 12th. Still haven't been picked up since the funeral, and he and his wife are pretty distant from each other right now. The family is suffering. The wind did blow my pages open right in front of him, but he just glanced down and walked away. November 28th. The whole family is visiting. Everyone's sitting around the table. Somebody asked what happens after someone dies, and they all had opinions. Nobody answered with any authority. Hopelessness filled the room. We talked about something else at that point. December 25th again. There's a Christmas party tonight, and he walked right by me. Luke 2 would be such a great place to start. Anywhere would be a great place to start.
Kind of a powerful thought. What would your Bible say about you this morning? Diary of a Bible, right? Well, we're going to be talking about the importance of God's Word this morning, and I'm invite you to get your Bibles out and open them up with me to the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah chapter 7. If you're using your pew Bible, you're looking for page 346. Excuse me. I'm going to do the best I can to get through this. I am battling between this head cold and this congestion and this cough I can't get rid of. Pastor Jim is on standby, so if I get to the point and I can't stop coughing, he's going to come up and relieve me, but we're going to try to suffer through this together. And the worst thing is for me to laugh, and so we can't have fun this service. We just got a straight face. Let's get through this, and we're going to have a good time anyway. But we've been working through, excuse me, I'm so sorry. We've been working through this book of Nehemiah, and it's been hopefully an incredible journey for you, as it has been for me. Nehemiah has been a significant book in my life on many different occasions, and we've been reading about this story, and really it's beyond a story. We're reading this historical account of this ordinary guy who serves an extraordinary God. And as he is going through this life, he's trying to figure out, what is my ultimate purpose? What is God's plan? What is God's will for my life? And chapter 1, he recognizes things are not as they ought to be. And so chapter 1, Nehemiah is seeing this need. Chapter 2 is Nehemiah rising to meet the challenge. He's recognizing that God has called him to some great, great things. And it has been exciting to see Nehemiah handle what God has brought his way. And we've been saying for quite some time that this phrase kind of summarizes Nehemiah's attitude, Nehemiah's life in many regards, this idea of watching, working, and praying every day. And the importance, and without question, as you walk through the story of Nehemiah, prayer is by far the number one most important thing that he does. Sometimes they're long, significant, drawn out, very intimate prayers, and sometimes they're very short, rifle shot kind of prayers that are right to the point. But both are very, very powerful. Nehemiah recognizes the importance of submitting to God's authority. Nehemiah recognizes in his life the value of what we have in James chapter 1, verse 5, although he didn't have it at the time. But James 1, 5 tells us, if anyone lacks wisdom, let him what? Ask God. And when you ask God for wisdom, God is faithful and he will give you what you need to know. Nehemiah followed Proverbs 3, 5 through 6, right? In all your ways, acknowledge God. Don't lean on your own understanding. Trust God and he'll direct your paths. He'll make your way straight. He'll guide you through this life. And this is exactly what we have seen going on with Nehemiah. And as he has been submitting to God's will for his life, we recognize what we said is a truth for any of us who decide to submit to God's will. And that is when we decide that we're going to get up and do something great for God, the enemy is going to do everything he can to oppose. And last week when we came together, we did something significant. We made it through four chapters of Nehemiah in one setting. Chapters 3, 4, 5, and 6. In chapter 3, we see the people, they get to work. Everybody's got a place in this thing that God wants them to do. And we said the same is true today. If you're sitting here today, it's because God's got something for you to do. He's not done yet. And you are where you are for a reason. And God wants to use you where you are in your family, in your work, in your neighborhood. God has got a plan for you. And God's got a plan for me. And when we submit to that, chapter 4, we recognize opposition is going to come. And we saw the different stages of that opposition. It starts with opposition from the outside. And when that doesn't work, it changes. And opposition comes from the inside. And that's exactly what we saw happen with Nehemiah. We said this, the devil will try to attack you from the outside, but after centuries of trying to persecute the church from the outside, the devil's recognized, every time I try to persecute the church, all that does is spread Christianity. Whenever I try to persecute God's people, all it does is spread the word and message of God, and that is very ineffective for me. So he decided, I'm going to join the church. And I'm going to do everything I can to mess up the church, the unity of the church from within. And so he starts sowing those problems. And when that opposition comes from within, that is the quickest, most dangerous thing that can happen in any ministry, is for opposition to rise up from the inside. And because we're not watching, working, praying like we ought to, we start to draw false conclusions about what's happening in our midst or in our lives. And pretty soon we're pointing a finger at everybody else and we don't like what they did or what she said or what he looks like or what preacher is planning. And we start getting upset with one another. And in that moment that we are no longer unified, the devil's on the outside thinking, yes, I've got him right where I want him. Because when there's disunity within, we crumble. We cannot focus on the purpose or God's will for our lives. And then we got to Nehemiah chapter 6 and we found out, well, when the opposition from the outside is not working, the opposition from the inside is not working, sometimes that devil will come and launch at a personal attack. He'll come right after you, and this is what we saw with Nehemiah, but we talked about the resolve that he had. Nehemiah 6:3, I am doing a great work. I'm not going to come down. Why would I come down for you? Or why would I come down for that? I am doing something God has called me to do. Why would I give up on my family? Why would I give up on my church? Why would I give up on those that I love? I am doing a great work. And that personal resolve that we see in Nehemiah's life. And so as we come to the end of chapter 6, or as we finished last week, we see the completion of a wall. But we said at that point, you got to be careful because just because the wall is completed, it doesn't mean that the work is done. And in fact, if we're not careful, we're going to accomplish something great like they did. Remember that impossible task that they could never complete, it was done in 52 days. And everybody from the inside and everybody from the outside looked at what they had accomplished and they said, wow, that can be nothing other than the work from their God. And their enemies became terrified. And the people were in awe at what God was able to accomplish. But if they're not careful, they'll set down the trowels and they'll set down the swords and they'll let down their guard, thinking that somehow or another there's this false sense of security and everything is okay. And somehow or another we have accomplished all that we have set out to do. Well, what we find out as you continue on in the book of Nehemiah is that that was just the beginning. It goes from rebuilding the wall to Nehemiah saying it's time to rebuild the people. Now is not the time to set down the guard. Now is not the time to relax and celebrate what we've accomplished. Now is the time to dig deeper and to respond in obedience to what God is asking us to do. And so as we come to our passages today, we're going to be talking about this concept of revival. That's the title that's at the top of your notes page, or the title of my sermon is revival. And I want you to understand what we mean by revival, because we're kind of in this culture where people hear the word revival and all of a sudden it's like we're thinking, well, revival is when a lot of people are getting saved at a church. And a revival, that can be a result of revival. A lot of people coming to church and getting saved. You'll see on the front of your bulletin, the word actually says awakening. And that's not bad. I actually like the idea of a concept. A revival literally means a spiritual reawakening. Because we are awakened once already, and a spiritual revival gets back to this point where we have a renewed excitement for God and for God's word and for the church. Remember how excited you were when you first got saved, and how on fire you were for God, and how exciting life was? And for some of you, that seems like such a distant memory so long ago, and you've been sitting in the pews now for 5, 10, 20, 30 years, and you've lost the fire. And you just kind of sit into routine, and you're here this morning, but that's just because, well, this is just habit. It's not because you have any great passion or desire. It's just, this is what I'm supposed to do, or this is what I'm used to doing. But revival, this idea of coming out of this place of spiritual stagnation and getting excited all over again about God and how big He is and how wonderful He is and all that He has done for you, and getting excited about what it is that He's got for your life. And you'll notice right there in your notes, that right underneath the title, you'll recognize that revival is near impossible outside of understanding the power and priority of God's Word in our lives. And this is why I started with the video I started with. Because we've got to evaluate what is the importance of God's Word in our life. Does it go beyond just simply showing up for church or simply owning a Bible? So as we come to Nehemiah chapter 7, if you're following along your notes, you'll see that chapter 7, we're going to start with laying the foundation. Revival is kind of coming in chapter 8, but chapter 7 is laying the proper foundation. The things that are necessary for spiritual revival. And as you come to this chapter, you'll recognize this is the longest one in the book of Nehemiah. And I will not attempt to read this all for you. I want to pull out just kind of the basic points that are being made here, starting with verse 1. And it says, after the wall had been rebuilt, and I had set the doors in place, the gatekeepers, the musicians, and the Levites were appointed. And at this part in the passage, we see Nehemiah's attention to every detail. He's orderly. He wants to do things proper in the way that they belong. And so what Nehemiah is doing is he's starting to take the steps that are necessary to safeguard Jerusalem. Yes, the wall is done, and yes, we hung the gates, but now it's time to start putting the right things in place, because this work is just getting going. And so he sees this need for putting godly leaders in place, putting the right security measures in place with the guards and all these other roles. In verse 2, he says, I put in charge of Jerusalem my brother Hanani, along with Hananiah, the commander of the citadel. Why? Why, Nehemiah, would you pick those guys? Because he was a man of integrity, and he feared God more than most people do. And so one of the first foundational elements of revival within a people group is godly leadership. And he says, I need a man of integrity. Somebody who can be honest. The Bible kind of finds it as being a person of uprightness. We really don't talk like that anymore. Today we'd say something more along the lines of, we need somebody with strong moral principles. Somebody who understands God's worth and the truth that it contains. And not simply a man of integrity, but somebody who fears God. And we talked about this a little bit last week. We're not talking about, when we say fear God, this idea like you're afraid of the dark, where you go crawl up in a corner and you get under the covers because you're afraid of what is out there. This idea of fearing God is respecting God, and fearing and respecting God more than fill in the blank. A man of integrity, a man who fears God, is a man who says, I fear God and what He says, and I hold that with higher esteem than I fear what you say. Or I fear God more than I fear what my parents tell me, or my siblings tell me, or my best friends tell me. And in other words, I make the decisions and choices I make. Why? Because God has told me, and I fear God more than I fear anybody else. And that's not simply the instruction, but that's also the opposition that may come along because we decide to get obedient and follow God. And so I fear God more than I fear my enemies from the outside, and I fear God more than I fear any uprising from within. And in other words, that God, a leader, subjects himself to God in every way. Verse 3 goes on in chapter 7. He said, "And I said to them, the gates of Jerusalem are not to be opened till the sun is hot. While the gatekeepers are still on duty, have them shut the doors and bar them. Also appoint residents of Jerusalem as guards, some at their posts and some near their own houses." And so what Nehemiah is starting to do is he is starting to put protection at the points of greatest weakness. Yes, the wall is done, but let's not put down the guard. Let's get people standing guard and pay attention to what's going on, and we need them all around. And so as the godly leadership's in place, and in other words, he's saying, listen, I need eyes and ears out there so I know where the problems are coming from, where I can know where the opposition is starting to bubble up, and we can deal with it because we're being vigilant to what is going on around us. The walls are done, but we're not letting down our guard. Because even though the walls are done, we've learned from chapter 6, the enemy still isn't done. And although they're somewhat afraid at what they're able to accomplish because of their God, they are still trying to rip up this group of people and trying to discourage them. And so the walls are done. Verse 4 says, "Now the city was large and spacious, but there were few people in it, and the houses had not yet been rebuilt." So the wall is good, but there's still a problem on the inside. We got our protection now from the enemy, but things still are not right within our own walls. The houses are still desolate. The people aren't where they belong. The population is sparse. And so the rest of chapter 7 is Nehemiah going about trying to set up the people that he needs to repopulate the city of Jerusalem. And as you look at verses 6 through 73, and I won't read them for you this morning, you can do that on your own time if you'd like, but this registration, and specifically registrations by family, and what we're recognizing is Nehemiah didn't want just anybody coming to be a part of what they were trying to do. Nehemiah was looking for people of verifiable Hebrew lineage. He wanted to know that we've got our own people who are coming back into this place. Because remember, there's people from the outside trying to get in, and there's people trying to get specifically on the inside. And if I can't corrupt you, I'm going to try to come to the inside myself and see if I can't corrupt everything else that's going on. And so Nehemiah says, "We want you back, but you better have the right lineage. You better be from the right families." And what Nehemiah is doing is trying to set the proper foundation. What he's recognizing is it's very important to have the right qualified people doing the work that God wants them to do, that God has called them to do. Now, we don't fully understand it today. We live in a different dispensation, a different age. But God had specific rules for these folks, for this nation at this time, and you were not to intermingle with other people. And so Nehemiah is saying, we got to have our people who understand what's going on, what God wants from us, to be here in our midst. And as you wanted to come, or as people wanted to come and be a part of that Jerusalem, that city that had been rebuilt, you better be able to prove your family heritage, your family lineage. And if you couldn't, you were kind of kept to the side until the priest could properly figure it out. And so Nehemiah recognizing, listen, if we want this thing to work, we better do it the way God told us to do it. And although you and I don't fully understand all those rules and regulations that they had, what they understood was, this is what God said, this is the way God wants it done, this is the way we're going to go about doing it. And so Nehemiah trying to set the proper foundation of godly leadership, people on the guard, trying to pay attention to what is going on, because Nehemiah recognizes those words that we read from Psalm 11:3, where it says that the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? And that the point of what every ministry should be doing, laying the right foundation, so that when we build on that, the work that we're building will last, that it'll stay and strong. And that foundation, it better be God's way of doing things, or else we're building on the wrong work. And this is what Nehemiah is recognizing. So the whole point of chapter 7 is getting the right people in place with the right foundation. And then we have the proper environment and atmosphere for that concept of revival. And as we come to chapter 8, we see this idea of rebuilding with truth. You see, the rebuilding with the blocks and mortar, that's done. We don't need the blocks, we don't need the mortar, we don't need the wood. That has all been accomplished. Now we rebuild with truth. Now we're working on the people. We're no longer reconstructing a wall. We are now re-instructing the people. And what's incredible is, even though this wall, which is a tremendous feat and really significant what they had accomplished, it doesn't compare to everything else God is going to accomplish in their lives from this point moving forward for the next several chapters. So as we come to chapter 8, let me just read some of this with you. There's a lot of verses here. Hopefully you got your Bibles out open to chapter 8, because there's a lot to put up on the screen this morning. But let's start at verse 1 in chapter 8. It said, all the people came together as one. And I love that, because we talked about the importance of unity. And as they're coming together, they're still unified. They still understand that we are here for this reason and for a particular purpose. And so they come together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. And I like that. If you want to start rebuilding with truth, here's the very first point. You've got to bring the word. I mean, after all, what is truth? Right? I mean, there's got to be some source, some foundation for what we claim to be truth. And it's so important that we get back to this book as our form of truth. I mean, otherwise, let's just be honest with this. We can argue opinions and preferences all day long, and nothing is ever really accomplished. But if you want truth, you've got to get the book. And you've got to bring the book. And I heard a preacher once, and it stuck with me ever since. I was fairly young. Some old preacher, and I don't know, he was probably a colored preacher just by the sound of his voice. But he's preaching on this. He got all passion. He says, the standard is bring the book. And I like that. That's where it's got to start. We need the book. And so it says, bring out the book, verse 2. And so on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. Now, follow me on this for just a second. What are all the prerequisites for being a part of what is about to take place? Number one, you had to be a man or a woman. Okay, everybody get up to that point. Second prerequisite, got to be able to hear. And finally, you got to be able to understand. That's it. A unified group coming together, and here comes Ezra to read the book, and all kinds of people, men are coming, women are coming, anybody who can hear or who are able to understand. And then verse 3, look at this. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, the women, and the others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. You know, a couple weeks back, we kind of skipped ahead in the book of Nehemiah, and we covered chapters 9 and 10. And we talk about in chapters 9 and 10 how they'd bring out God's word, and they would read it, and they would worship, and they would repent, and they would go at that for 6 hours at a time. And at that time, we told you, they had been doing that for over 3 weeks. Listen, this is where it started. They started by bringing the book. And they brought the book out, and Ezra starts reading it. And it says, from daybreak till noon, that's approximately 6 hours worth of time. And I love where it says, and all the people listened attentively. I'm hardly six verses into my message, and some of you are already falling asleep. Some of you are on Facebook, and some of you are texting, and some of you are distracted about what you're eating for lunch afterwards, and some of you are still distracted by the fact the preacher didn't tuck in his shirt today, and some of you are distracted by the fact that your neighbor is wearing too much perfume, or that guy didn't put on enough deodorant, or whatever. For 6 hours, they read the book. And for 6 hours. It said they all listened attentively. You know what I think that means? I think for 6 hours they all listened. Because as this revival is fixing to break out, they are excited once again, not only about God, but about God's Word. They are tired of the spiritual stagnation that is going on in their lives. And for the first time in over 100 years, the people of Israel are hearing God's Word, and they are getting excited about what that means. Verse 4 says, Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. And next to him were all the other priests. And verse 5 says, and Ezra opened the book, and all the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. It says, Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, Amen, Amen. Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. This is incredible. Because they brought the book. And not only did they bring the book, you could break this down, verses 1 through 4, they bring the book. Verses 5 through 6, they opened the book. Right? I see this every week. People come into this place and they bring their Bibles and it stays closed on the pew next to them the whole time they're here. Or like the diary of the Bible that we just read about. You've got this thing at home, but it stays closed on your end table day in and day out, year in, year out, and you never open the book. Listen, you can't have a spiritual revival in your life if you don't start with the truth. If you don't bring the book and open the book. And this is what they do. And they read it, and the response is, Amen, Amen. In other words, let it be. Yeah, that sounds great. Let's do what that thing just said. And it goes on. Verse 7, then the Levites, and a bunch of names you don't care to hear this morning, they instructed the people and the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. I love it. They brought the book, they opened the book, and then they explained the book. Ah, isn't that something? I mean, I open it, and I get this on occasion. We need to have it explained to us, don't we? We need to understand or try to understand or have someone tell us, what on earth did I just read? I don't know what that means, but to keep that from being an excuse, the Levites, the people who were trained in the law, went around, now, do you have a question? And do you have a question? And let me explain it to you. That's why we have pastors today. That's why we have Bible teachers and Bible studies and all these resources, so that the Word, excuse me, I'm sorry. So that the so that the Word can be explained and we can understand it and we can learn how to live by it in our lives. See, Nehemiah completely understood. What we got here? Oh, cough drops. That's just what you need. Hear me sucking on one of those. Thank you. Nehemiah, he understands the importance of God's Word in their life. And that's still true for us today. There's an important scripture that we all know and we all love. 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. These are one of those verses that everybody loves to quote. But do you understand what these verses are really saying? The scriptures, I mean, it's all inspired, and that's incredible, okay? It's God-breathed, and we believe that, and it's useful for teaching, and we like that. But then we stop where it says rebuking. Why? Because it's painful. Have any of you ever seen the skit by the skit guys called the God Chisel? And basically the prayer is, God, I want you to make me a better person. And God shows up with his hammer and his chisel. And he goes, ding, ding, ding. Ding, 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 ding. Ow. That hurt. Can you not do that? Oh, I thought you want me to make it better. I do, but I don't want any pain involved in the process. Listen, we've got to go beyond recognizing that God's word is simply good for teaching. It's got to be good for rebuking. And that word rebuking means to expose. I mean, its most simple form, to expose, to help you understand. Yes, we taught you, and now we go about living life. And as you're living life, I'm recognizing, as your pastor or somebody else is recognizing, you are still not doing or acting or behaving the way you ought to act. And so we come along your side and say, look, according to God's word, you ought not to be a gossip. And, oh, don't you talk to me about that, preacher. That hurts. Why? Because we're exposing. But this is what Nehemiah recognizes. We've got to expose the sin if we're going to overcome, and it doesn't become cancerous amongst our midst and make us sick and unhealthy and ultimately kill our church. Isn't this exactly what we saw Nehemiah doing back in chapter 5? As the opposition from the inside began to rise, he looked at his fellow Jews with anger in his heart, and he said, listen, what you're doing is not right. He is rebuking them. And then he kind of carried on the process where he corrected them in training and righteousness. And that's now, correcting means to make straight. Let me show you how to straighten out your life. And this is what God's word does. As you are taught and as you are rebuked and those areas are exposed, it leads to straight line. Understanding this is the direction I ought to be traveling. This is how I ought to be living. And training is how we keep you there. And that's what Nehemiah did. What you guys aren't doing isn't right. The way you ought to behave is like this. And he used his own life as an example of how you ought to live. You guys are taking advantage of your fellow Jews. I'm doing everything I can to buy them out of slavery and to focus on what God has called me to do. Why not? Because I'm great. Because I'm staying focused on the purpose that God has set before me. And so Nehemiah wants us to understand the importance of God's word. And listen, you cannot compromise. See, the more you compromise, the more the word of God loses its power and ability to change and transform your life. The more you sit and you say, well, I like that, but I don't like that, you try to pick and choose what you obey and what you don't obey, at that point you start playing God. And that is unhealthy. God's word is important. And as they bring God's word, as they open the book, as they explain the book, what this leads to, we see in chapter 9, it says, then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest, and the teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people, said to them all, this day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep, for all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. And so God's word is cutting to the heart. The rebuking process was painful. It's driving them to their knees, recognizing we have not been obedient to all that God has asked us to do. They're recognizing we are struggling and suffering in the way that we are because we have been disobedient to God's rule in our lives. And then Nehemiah, verse 10, he says, go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. And so here's what we see after they bring the word. They celebrate the word. They're celebrating the power of God's word in their lives. Yes, it's exposed some things. And yes, it's been painful. In fact, it's driven them to the point of grief and tears. And Nehemiah and the priests are saying, no, stop. This is a good day. Because now we know what God's law says. We can celebrate because we now have what we need to not end up in the same place that we've just come out of. We can avoid the behaviors that put us in this place to begin with, and now go and find some other people and celebrate this wonderful truth. Verse 11, it says, Levites calmed all the people, saying, be still, for this day is a holy day. Do not grieve. Verse 12, then all the people went away to eat and drink and to send portions of food to celebrate with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them. Talk about a renewed excitement for God's word. They're going away partying after they're just driven to tears and grief. something. This is a great day. We've got God's word, and it's powerful and effective, and this is an absolutely incredible time. And yes, it will convict, and yes, it will bring grief, but that means it also brings cleansing and forgiveness so that we can re-enter into this relationship with the Lord, and the result is a celebration. And then, verse 13, on the second day of the month, the heads of all the families, along with the priests and the Levites, gathered around Ezra, the teacher, to give attention to the words of the law. So they showed up for another 6 hours of reading. How many of y'all show up next week if I just sat here and read from the Bible for 6 hours? I'm not sure I'd show up next week. I mean, Genesis, that's okay. And Exodus, that's all right. But Leviticus, I mean, come on. Numbers. Y'all would be bored out of your mind, wouldn't you? Isn't it funny how we have a different perspective? They're getting excited about what's going on in their lives. More so than anything else that has been happening. And so, as we come to verse 13, the last point of what I want you to see going on in this process after they celebrate is they start obeying the word. And as you look at verses 13 through 18, this is exactly what's going on. Verses 13 through 18, I'm not going to read it all for you this morning. But basically, they decide that they're going to follow God's law and they're going to observe the festival of booths. And in other words, they're celebrating this moment in their history. Remember when God led them up out of slavery in Egypt? And they're out there in the wilderness, and because they're unfaithful, God says, okay, you're all out here for 40 years. But for that 40 years, he provided for them. And he took care of them. And they built these little huts that they would live in. Somebody this morning said, it sounds a lot like camping. It kind of does. But God's law said, listen, I want you to do that. Why would you want us to do this? He says, because I want you to remember my faithfulness. And I want you to teach my faithfulness to future generations. It's kind of like today. Why do we celebrate Christmas? It shouldn't be for the present. It says, let's remember the fact Christ came. Let's celebrate what he's done for us. Why do we do communion? Right? It's not to crucify Christ all over again, but let's celebrate the sacrifice that was made for us. Let's look back and remember all the great things. And so they decided as they're reading the law that this is what the law told them to do. And so they decided, okay, we're going to go out and do it. And they obey the law. And they decide, you know what, we've got to bless and honor God because of how good he is. But it's impossible to bless and honor God if you are not obedient to what God tells you to do. So they decide, you know what, we're going to be obedient. Let me share with you very quickly so you get it for your notes why it's so important or why God's word is so important in our lives. And the number one thing I want you to see is that it teaches us who God is. God's word, it teaches me who God is. Listen, this is important because we tend to create our own God, right? We all think of God based on our own understanding. And some of us try to put him in a little box and think, okay, you've got to do this and do that because this is my perspective of who you are. And boy, don't you dare operate outside of that box or my expectations or else it's going to upset me or I'm not going to know how to respond or how to deal with it. And we need passages like Isaiah 55:8 where God says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. Listen, we need God's word. And God says, I understand that. And you'll never fully understand God, but listen, he's revealed what we need to know. He's revealed enough that it can give us a proper perspective of who he is so that we can also be people of integrity and we can also be people who learn to fear God because of who he is and what he has done for us. Listen, we start to frame God in that little box or think we know who he is, we're going to destroy our lives. I'm glad God is so much bigger and so much more understanding and knowledgeable than I am. Right? And pretending to go tell God who he is or we think we know what's best for us is no different than your four-year-old coming up to you and saying, Mom, Dad, you've done good, but I think I've got it from here on out. I think I know enough about this life. I really don't need you anymore. I really don't think your influence in my life is very important. And forget the four-year-old. How about our teenagers? Right? It's like, what are you, outside your mind? You'd kill yourselves. You'd destroy your lives. And I think God looks down at us with the same perspective. You think you're so smart. If I let you guys to yourselves, you'd destroy yourselves. Listen, we need God's word because it teaches me who God is. Number two, it teaches me who I am. And that's important because we all think we are so much better than we really are. Don't we? Because what we tend to do, what I tend to do, what you tend to do, is we tend to look at somebody else who's a little bit worse. And think, so long as I'm doing better than them. I knew it was a few nights ago, I saw this sick story about this guy who abused his children, and that disgusts me. Actually, that angers me, I'll be honest with you. And it's easy to think, at least I'm better than that idiot. But the Bible teaches me who I am, not measured against who somebody else is or is not. But the Bible teaches me who I am in light of who God is and what He expects from me. And when we get to that point, we find out we all fall woefully short of the standards that God has for us. We think we do so good. Isaiah 64, 6 reminds us that all of our righteous acts are like filthy rags to God. And unless you understand the context and reality of that statement, filthy rags, just to give you a hint, has something to do with the female cycle, all right? Disgusting, nasty. And this is the comparison that's being made right here. You think you're so good. You think you got so much. The best that you can do in the sight of God is like filthy rags. You got nothing. See, but we need the Word of God because it teaches us who we really are and what God really wants from us. And thirdly, it teaches me how to live. Here's the reality. God created this universe and all that is in it. And God created you and God created me. And because He created it, this word tells us how we can flourish within that creation. And you know why this is so hard. Because it doesn't make sense in our minds. Right? It doesn't square with what the world considers smart or logic. I'm glad it doesn't, aren't you? I mean, we need the Bible to tell us how to live. I mean, it doesn't make any sense, but that's what you need the relationship. There are so many paradoxes in the Bible. You understand that? If we don't read this book, we'll never figure it out. Things like, you know what? You live by dying. That's got to be from the Bible, right? You gain hope by suffering. You gain strength when you're weak. You're made great by becoming small. Listen, if you want to learn how to flourish in this creation, stop putting all your trust into the wisdom that the world has to offer. You need God's Word. And when you have God's Word, it'll teach you all about who God is. It'll teach you all about who you are. It'll teach you all about how you can live and flourish and experience, listen to me, joy in this world, regardless of whatever else is going on. And that's just simply the power of God's Word. Look at Nehemiah 8:17. As we talk about them obeying God's Word and the power and priority of God's Word in their lives, as they decide to be obedient, 17, it says, the whole company that had been returned from exile built temporary shelters and lived in them. From the days of Joshua, son of Nun, until that day, the Israelites had not celebrated it like this, and their joy was very great. In a temporary house? Yeah. Why? Because they're camping. No. Because God said, this is what I want you to do. And when you will submit to my word, listen, it doesn't matter what condition the walls are in. It doesn't matter what condition all the other houses are in. It doesn't matter what is going on from the outside of the enemies. You just get into my word and you'll be obedient and you let it have its way in your life. And you can experience joy regardless of what is happening around you. That's the power of God's word. And when we get to God's word and we obey it, then things happen. Good things happen. And even in those hard times when we don't understand what God is doing, we can experience that joy. That's the invitation of this book. to get the book, to open it, to read it, to have it explained, to understand it, to celebrate it, to obey it. And when you do, it will transform your life. And so this idea of revival, just by way of question this morning, are you tired of spiritual stagnation? Are you tired of just the week in, the week out, the same old? Are you ready for renewed excitement for God? This is what revival is. Renewed excitement for God and your relationship with Him. A renewed excitement for God's Word. A renewed excitement for church. Doing fellowship in life with one another. These things are not possible if you do not understand the power and priority of God's Word in your life. See, the reality is the Bible is the only tool that we have to get us to where God wants us to be. And see, when we say that, we've been saying it fairly often around here. It's our desire to see people go from where they are to where God wants them to be. And we can follow the wisdom of the world to try to do that, but that won't really get us anywhere. We need God's Word to be successful in this process. In Bible circles, it's called sanctification, becoming more like Christ, because that's the reality of where God wants you to be. Every day, God wants you becoming more like Christ. And listen, without His Word, without opening it up, without reading it, without applying it, you don't get to move along that spectrum. What we see in this Word is an invitation to a life of ever-increasing joy. But the reality is it must be based on God's plan and God's instruction. This morning, just by way of application, I want you to think about this in your own heart and mind this morning. This morning, are you willing to say, I want to renew my commitment to God's Word. And I want to make God's Word a priority in my life. This morning, are you at a place where you're tired of simply living on the cutting edge of mediocrity? Some people are pretty happy there. When's the last time you were attentive to God's Word? When's the last time you wept over your sin? When's the last time you had a party just because of how great God is? You invited all your friends over and said, let's just celebrate. I was reading God's Word today, and I learned this awesome truth, and it gave me great insight on life. Let's have a party. Have you ever done that? That's sad, isn't it? I'm not sure I ever have either. I mean, I have fellowships and stuff all the time. But maybe we should do that. Maybe we should get fired up about God's Word and get after this thing of doing life together and celebrating with one another and getting revived as we walk out of this place of spiritual stagnation and get excited all over again for God and our relationship with Him and for His Word. Stand with me if you would. The team's going to come and lead us in a song as we close called How Great Thou Art. And as they come to lead us in this song, I'm sure that there's things in your life that need to be rebuilt. And I don't know what they are, and you've got to do business with God. But the kind of rebuilding we're talking about at this point is not talking about stones and mortar. If you need to be rebuilding anything in your life, it's got to start with the truth, the priority of God's Word. And so if you need to come pray, I invite you to come pray. If you got questions, I'd be happy to talk with you. Just stay about 3 feet away from me. Or come see me later on in the week, or come talk with Pastor Jim. We'll pray with you. We'll pray for you. We'll encourage you however we possibly can. But the Spirit's leading your heart this morning. You do business with God before you leave this place.